HarperCollins presents The Scam That Shook a Nation, The Nagarwala Scandal. Written by Prakash Patra and Rasheed Kidwai. Read by Adwait, Karambelkar. Dedication. Prakash Patra would like to dedicate this book to his parents, Bidyut Chaya and Ganeshwar Patra. Rasheed Kidwai would like to dedicate this book to his cousin and late friend, Abdul Ali Kidwai. A note for listeners before we begin. Don't forget to download the enhanced PDF containing supporting material for this title from your audiobook provider. Author's note. The relations between rhetoric and ethics are disturbing. The ease with which language can be twisted is worrisome. And the fact that our minds accept these perverse games so docilely is no less cause for concern. Octavio Paz. The 1970s were a watershed period for Indian politics. The turbulent decade saw the division of Pakistan and a war, a feather in India's political and military cap. The country going nuclear, the loss of political morality, and the emergence of a rainbow coalition of opposition parties that included opinions aligned to the right. But before all these momentous events took place, something else would leave the nation gasping in collective disbelief. In the summer of 1971. More than half a century later, the Nagarwala affair, the scam that shook the nation, remains as enigmatic as ever. And not only because of the then mind-boggling sum of 60 lakh rupees that was withdrawn from a public sector bank on a mere verbal command over telephone, purportedly from the highest echelons of the government in power at the center. In 1971, the sum of 60 lakh rupees was no joke. As per Scribbox and the inflation calculator on it, the amount would have been 170.62 crore rupees in 2024. Readers who take the trouble of going through the labyrinth of 23 chapters in this book will perhaps understand why we, as authors, had to make a conscious effort to be politically neutral. At the same time, it was also necessary to document the lackadaisical approach of the entire system. When one goes through the reams of papers related to the Nagarwala saga, one can see a clear pattern. There is admission of guilt, but the identities of the real culprits remain hazy to many. The commission set up to probe the scam reached its conclusions, but its assumptions are debatable. The investigation process was speedy, in fact, too speedy, to allay doubts. The purpose of presenting this work is simple. The story, the subplot, the sequence of events, the characters and the issues involved make the Nagarwala saga irresistible. It has all the ingredients of a thriller, replete with tragedy, farce, human feelings, greed, pretentiousness and misuse of authority. What we have tried to do, to the best of our abilities, is present the facts as they occurred and let the discerning listener decide whether we have succeeded in our attempt to reconstruct what happened so many decades ago. We thank the Director General of the National Archives of India, Chandan Sinha, and his colleagues Dr. Sumita Das Mojumdar and Farid Ahmed for their help in facilitating access to archival material. Our friends Shankar Raghuraman, Archis Mohan, Jagjeevan Bakshi, Amitabh Shukla, Pradeep Sharma, Pooja Gupta, Gautam Kumar, Vidyut Patra, Anshuman Mohanty, Priyaranjan Nayak, Sukanta Sahu, Neeta Nagraj, and Jasmine Singh for their encouragement and support in this endeavor. This book would not have seen the light of day without the support of Swati Chopra, She understood the delicate nature of the book in the context of the politics of the era when the scandal took place, and its potential future. She shared our thrust on political neutrality and our quest for a comprehensive morality. A big thank you to Ujjaini Dasgupta, who meticulously went through the text. Her eye for detail, insightful suggestions, and observant approach were invaluable. Our deep sense of gratitude to our friend and former colleague, Ananda Sen, who went through the manuscript and came up with pertinent observations regarding both the structure and the text. Prakash Patra and Rasheed Kidwai, New Delhi, April 2024. Section 1. The Phone Call. The Heist. The Trial. Chapter 1. The Loot. Ved Prakash Malhotra leaned back in his chair. Monday mornings were usually busy for banks, but the chief cashier seemed relaxed. He had no reason not to be. Malhotra had joined the State Bank of India when it was known as the Imperial Bank 26 years ago and had risen through the ranks to become chief cashier at the bank's Parliament Street branch, a post specially created for him in recognition of his hard work and dedication. It was a position of trust and responsibility. That was 11 years back. Now 46, after a lifetime of hawk-eyed handling of cash at the SBI's local head office at a sprawling building dating back to 1873, he could afford to relax a bit. What Malhotra didn't know was that his life was about to change, and dramatically, that 24th May morning in 1971. It was 11:45 a.m. Malhotra was in his cabin talking to a client when one of the three telephones on his desk rang. It was the direct number, 45468, not the one connected to the SBI exchange or the intercom, which meant the call was from outside. The chief cashier picked up the phone. "Shri Haksar, Secretary to the Prime Minister of India, wants to talk to you," said the voice at the other end. "Put him through," Malhotra replied. There was a pause, then another voice came on the line, purportedly that of P.N. Haksar, the secretary to the Prime Minister.
"I am secretary to the PM speaking."
"Namaste," Malhotra replied. "What are your orders?" "I have to talk to you about a very secret matter, and if there is anyone sitting in your room, he must be asked to go," the voice at the other end said. Malhotra placed a hand on the receiver and looked at the man sitting across the table. "Please wait outside," he said. "I have an important call to attend." Mathura Das, retired honorary magistrate of Delhi, was a respected client. But it was not every day that one got a call from the Prime Minister's secretary. That too about something very secret. Das would later recall how taken aback he was at Malhotra's unacceptable behavior. He had known Malhotra for a long time, and the chief cashier had always been courteous. As Das got up and stepped outside the glass cabin, Malhotra spoke into the phone again, telling the person at the other end there was no one else in the room. What followed was a series of terse, cryptic orders, not dissimilar to what readers of espionage stories would expect, but enough to arouse Malhotra's interest and kindle long-dormant feelings of nationalism. "The Prime Minister of India wants 60 lakh rupees to be sent for a work that is very highly secret in nature. She will send a person and you can hand over the money to him," the person at the other end told Malhotra. The chief cashier asked whether the money would be handed over against a check or a receipt. "It is a very urgent and secret work. This is what the PM's orders are. Receipt or check will be given later," the voice replied, almost peremptory in tone, before going on to bark out further instructions.
Take the money in a van to the Free Church, because this money has to be sent to Bangladesh by an Air Force plane. This is a work of urgent nature and should not be disclosed to anyone. And you should come soon. In his long career at the bank, Malhotra had never been in such a situation. Handling cash demanded total attention, but this was different. "It is a very difficult task," he stammered. "Then you talk to the PM of India, Srimati Indira Gandhi," the voice replied. And a moment later, Malhotra heard a familiar voice come on the line. "I am the PM of India, Srimati Indira Gandhi speaking." Malhotra couldn't believe he was speaking to Indira Gandhi. At the other end, the new voice came directly to the point. "As my secretary has just now informed you, 60 lakh rupees is urgently required in Bangladesh for an important secret work. Get it ready quickly. I am sending my courier. At the place indicated by Haksar, you hand over the money to him." Malhotra was now confident that the voice on the other side was that of the Prime Minister of India. He relaxed. "How will I be able to identify the person?" he asked. "The person will talk to you in code words and will say, 'I am Bangladesh Kababu.' You reply, 'I am bar at law.' By this, you will be assured that he is my courier. Thereafter, you proceed as he says," the person at the other end replied. "After delivering the money, come straight to my house and you will get a receipt." Then the line went dead. Conversation over. For long, Malhotra, a victim of the partition and a migrant, had been wanting to do something for the nation. But the opportunity had never arisen, and he had immersed himself in his unspectacular, though steady, bank job. Now, all of a sudden, fate had thrown him a line to redeem himself in his own eyes. It was true that what he had been told to do was fraught with uncertainty. But how many like him had had the privilege of receiving orders directly from the Prime Minister? Malhotra would later say he was spellbound after speaking to Indira Gandhi. But there was little time to waste. The chief cashier got up and stepped out of his cabin, only to see Das standing outside. It was clear the elderly client was upset at being asked to step outside Malhotra's cabin. Malhotra, too, had sensed the older man's feelings of hurt. He apologized, touched Das's knee and said, "I am going on an important mission of national importance." Das, not unaccustomed to the Punjabi way of obeisance, patted Malhotra on the shoulder and wished him success. Malhotra then knocked on the cabin assigned to his deputy, Ram Prakash Patra, and asked him how many bundles of 100-rupee notes he had with him. The deputy chief cashier glanced at the cash register lying on his table and replied, "About 180 or 190 bundles. Roughly 1.8 to 1.9 lakh rupees. "Arrange 60 lakh ke bidda, wards. It is for a payment," Malhotra told Patra. "Get the money from the strongroom currency chest and put the amount in another chest." There was a tone of urgency in his voice. After Malhotra left, Patra walked up to the cabin of Hakumat Rai Khanna, the cash in charge, who sat in the savings bank section a little away from Malhotra's room. Khanna, along with Patra, held separate keys to the currency chest in the strong room as joint custodians. Patra informed Khanna that the chief cashier needed 60 lakh rupees immediately. As they spoke, Malhotra entered the room. When Khanna asked Malhotra why so much money was needed, the chief cashier told him it was top secret work, but promised to explain the details after the disbursement. Patra and Khanna then moved towards the strong room, which had an elaborate security system. To enter the strong room, three locks had to be opened. Khanna had the control key for two of the locks. He used it and the two locks opened. The cash in charge then inserted the second key, the one for the third lock. Khanna simultaneously inserted a key of his own, and the main door of the strong room opened. Now two more locks needed to be opened to access the cash chest. Khanna inserted his key to open the first lock of the grill door, and the other lock opened when Batra applied his key. The two then opened the chest with two separate keys. While Batra withdrew the amount, Khanna counted the 100-rupee bundles before the wads were put in a designated trunk. Malhotra walked into the strong room to see whether the amount was being correctly packed. Khanna again asked Malhotra the purpose behind withdrawing the huge amount, that too at such short notice. Malhotra repeated what he had said earlier. It was a heavy payment, he said, adding that he would reveal the details after the money was handed over. Malhotra then left the strong room and returned to his cabin. Once the money was withdrawn, two coolies, Surinder Kumar and UD Sharma, lifted the trunk and carried it to the head cashier, Rawel Singh's cabin. Back in his cabin, Malhotra rang up the security officer, S.C. Sinha, who was in the bank's adjoining old building. The call on the intercom was received by Barun K. Mitra, the assistant security officer. Malhotra asked Mitra to allot him an ambassador as he had to go out on a top-secret official assignment. The chief cashier also told Mitra that he did not require a driver as he would drive the official ambassador himself. Mitra told Malhotra he would not be able to provide him a car without a driver. While they spoke, security officer Sinha walked in. He told Mitra that he had already spoken to Malhotra on the intercom and had told the chief cashier that a car, DLK 760, would be allotted, but that he wouldn't be allowed to drive it. Santosh Kumar, a driver, would be at the wheel. Sinha also told Kumar not to give the car keys to Malhotra. Back at the strong room, Batra and Khanna again carried out the elaborate procedure to secure the vault after the money had been taken out. Batra then met head cashier Singh in his room and got the vault register signed, recording the withdrawal of 60 lakh rupees in cash. Once the necessary entries had been made, Malhotra came down from his office and walked to the bank compound gate, where the bank's cars were parked. The two coolies brought the cash box to where the ambassador waited. Car driver Kumar and a security guard, Man Bahadur, were present at the spot. Kumar opened the trunk and the two coolies heaved the box inside. The dickey could not be closed due to the size of the box, Kumar would say in his statement to the police later. Batra handed over the keys of the cash trunk to Malhotra, who got in behind the wheel and drove off. Kumar would later complain to his boss, the security officer, that Malhotra took away the car by driving himself after virtually snatching the keys from him. Malhotra did not let Man Bahadur accompany him either. It was 12:15 p.m., barely half an hour since Malhotra had received the phone call that would change his life forever. Malhotra was to meet the courier at 12:30 p.m. I realized that it would be better to let R.P. Batra know that in case I was delayed at the Prime Minister's house, he should supervise my work in my absence, he would later say in his statement to the police. Malhotra told them that he drove back to inform Batra. I came back and called Batra downstairs and said, "Brother, take care of my work." Malhotra stopped the car across the road, barely 100 paces from the SBI's Parliament Street branch near the Free Church, a 1927 distinctive red and white neo-colonial style building. As he had been instructed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.